Hello, I'm Roger Mudd. Welcome to the History Channel. It was on December 8, 1941, one day after Pearl Harbor, that the United States declared war on Japan. That was also the start of an undeclared war against many Japanese Americans. More than 100,000 Japanese immigrants and their children were taken from their homes and put in relocation centers or internment camps. But despite the humiliating treatment, several thousand young Japanese men desperately wanted a chance to fight for their adopted country. On our program, Gerald McCraney tells the story of two combat units made up almost entirely of Nisei, second-generation Japanese Americans. Their loyalty and patriotism was questioned by their fellow soldiers until the Nisei saw action in Italy and France. Join us now as the History Channel presents Most Decorated, the Nisei Soldiers.
The Bronze Star, the Purple Heart, the Distinguished Service Cross. With these decorations, the United States Army honors the bravest and most heroic efforts of its soldiers. But these medals only symbolize courage of the battlefield, the courage to confront a foreign enemy. There is another kind of courage for which the Army awards no medals. This is the courage to confront an enemy on the home front. In World War II, one unit was forced to face both kinds of enemies and was found to have both kinds of courage. This is the story of the 100th Battalion and the 442nd Combat Team.
The 100th and 442nd were special outfits. They fought in Italy and France for only a year and a half. But in that short time, they earned 5 Distinguished Unit Citations, 48 Distinguished Service Crosses, and over 3,600 Purple Hearts. Even more important than what this combat team carried away from battle is what they carried in. All the members of this unit were Nisei, second-generation Japanese Americans. Before they ever reached combat, before they were ever allowed to fight, these soldiers were considered the enemy.
All of us, in addition to fighting the enemy, had a goal, which was an added incentive to succeed, and that was to redeem our name, to uphold our honor. Failure was almost impossible. You had to succeed.
No one was more surprised by the events of December 7, 1941 than Americans of Japanese descent, nor were anyone's lives more utterly changed.
It was a Sunday, and as we have done for so many years, the family was getting ready for church. And I remember at that moment I was putting on my necktie. Once a week I put on a necktie. And then the radio suddenly came out with a hysterical voice.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, by air, President Roosevelt has just announced.
From his Honolulu home, Daniel Inouye could see dark clouds of smoke over Pearl Harbor.
Something must have happened, some explosion or some accident. Then suddenly, at about that moment, 3 fighter planes swooped right above us. And you could see the gray color, and on the wings were red dots. And I knew enough to figure that out, that they were Japanese. And I knew we were in trouble.
When war broke out, 150,000 people of Japanese descent lived on the U.S. mainland. An equal number lived on Hawaiian islands. In 1924, Congress decreed that first-generation Japanese, the Issei, could not become citizens. Their children, Nisei, felt themselves part of America. When Japan launched its surprise attack, Nisei sentiments were clear.
Regardless of how much they looked like us, the Japanese were attacking Hawaii, my home.
I'm like anybody else. I mean, if you attack my home, I'm gonna fight back. That's the feeling we had.
I felt that a war was inevitable and that I would do everything in my power to help my country, the United States of America.
But the Nisei were not allowed to defend their country. Soon after December 7, as other young men signed up, the U.S. Army deemed the Nisei unfit for military service, giving them draft designation 4C, enemy alien. Soon, the U.S. government saw enemy aliens in every Japanese face. On February 21, 1942, President Franklin Roosevelt signed Executive Order 9066, demanding the removal of all Japanese Americans from the West Coast. With a sweep of his pen, FDR closed businesses, froze bank accounts, and uprooted tens of thousands of citizens from their homes. Officially, relocation was done to protect Japanese Americans in case of a mainland invasion. In truth, it was born out of something much deeper. At the beginning of 1942, Mary Saito lived in Los Angeles with her father and four brothers. The middle brother, George Saito, owned a thriving produce business. When the order for evacuation came, Saito and her family, like many others in Los Angeles, reported to the Santa Anita racetrack to be processed.
Santa Anita was horrible. We were one of the fortunate ones in that we didn't have to live in a horse stable, but some of the families were put into horse stables. And when it rained, the odor was a little strong.
After being processed, the Saitos were relocated to a barren stretch of eastern Colorado, a camp called Amache. Other internees were dispersed to equally desolate corners of the West, from Manzanar in California to Jerome in Arkansas. Jimmy McKino was a high school sophomore near Los Angeles when his family was removed to a remote stretch of Arizona desert, Gila River.
And when we arrived in Gila, we couldn't believe what we were seeing, a huge project of nothing. Homes half built, that is barrack types, with stacks of lumber just all over the place. No shade, no nothing.
Not a single case of espionage was proven against any Japanese American. Yet 110,000 were put behind barbed wire, watched over by armed guards, and told to make themselves a home. In Hawaii, where Japanese Americans were essential to the island economy, few were relocated to camps. Authorities here had a different problem. What to do with the 1,500 Nisei already serving in the National Guard? When war broke out, the non-Japanese soldiers became part of the regular army, not the Nisei.
About 2 or 3 weeks after December the 7th, one night they took away all of our rifles and ammunition, and these were only from the Japanese boys. There was a rumor that the Japanese citizens in Honolulu were going to riot.
I still feel the emotional pangs of that moment when I unbuckled my sidearms and turned it over to my commanding officer.
Stripped of their arms, the Hawaiian Nisei spent the first months of the war in a labor battalion. Most of these Hawaiian soldiers were close friends. Many had gone to the same high schools, come from the same plantations. Besides a common background, they also shared a desire, the desire to go to combat and to defend their honor. In 1941, Daniel Inoue was too young to enter the service, but he shared the frustration of the Nisei already in uniform.
Conceivably, all of us could have sat out the war without endangering ourselves, but I think life would have been a bit different. We decided otherwise, that we were just as good as Americans, and we wanted to demonstrate to one and all that we should be considered Americans.
In early June 1942, the Nisei soldiers thought they would get a chance to defend their home. It was the eve of the Battle of Midway, a crucial confrontation. Most believed if the Japanese won the battle, they would then turn and move on the islands of Hawaii. On June 3rd, however, as the battle was about to begin, all 1,500 Nisei soldiers were hustled aboard a troop ship and sent towards the mainland. The army didn't want them around when the shooting began. On June 6, 1942, the U.S. scored a stunning victory over the Japanese at Midway. The fear of a Japanese invasion of the U.S. mainland was now lifted. The Nisei soldiers learned of this as they arrived at Camp McCoy, Wisconsin. They also learned they would be formed into a combat unit, the 100th Infantry Battalion. At this point, the Army didn't really know what to do with the Nisei soldiers. It had no plans to use them in combat. Instead, the Army assigned the Nisei Caucasian officers and told them to start training.
All of the fellows in the 100 were already in the Army. So they were trained soldiers. And so to go through another cycle of basic training was kind of to me, it was a waste of time, but we had to go through it.
It wasn't just that these Nisei looked like the enemy. In 1942, the Army didn't consider any Asians suitable for combat. A 24-year-old Korean-American, young Oak Kim, realized this as he graduated from Officers' Candidate School. He finished second in his class.
When I got done, I was told I could be one of three things: a cook, a clerk, or a mechanic. I said, but I did real well. Why can't I be a soldier? They said, no. In fact, he says, we've got too many cooks and we've got too many clerks, so you're going to be a mechanic. I said, I don't know anything about mechanics. We'll send you to school. I said, well, I want to be a soldier. They said, no, you can't be a soldier. You got the wrong color skin, the wrong color eyes and everything. He said, you can't be a soldier.
When Kim finally joined the 100th, the Army's decision about what to do with the Nisei was being made for them. In 12 months of training, the 100th had scored the highest mark in inspection. It was now July 1943. The United States was fighting a war on two fronts and was desperate for men. The War Department had no choice. It decided to try an experiment and use the Nisei in combat. On September 21st, the 100th Battalion arrived in Salerno, Italy, and joined the 5th Army's push up the Italian peninsula. The 5th Army commander, General Mark Clark, reminded the Nisei of their status. In his greeting, he called them the guinea pigs from Pearl Harbor.
We always wanted to go to combat. We knew that was the only way could solve the problem of the question is, are you loyal or not loyal? There's only one way to do it, and that's to go to combat. And you have to spill blood, your own blood.
On September 29th, on a road near the small town of Chusano, the first Nisei blood was spilt. Shrapnel from German artillery struck and killed Sergeant Joe Takata. The Nisei realized proving loyalty came with a price.
When everybody saw Joe Takata dead on the side of the road, you know, with that rifle with the bayonet stuck in the ground and his helmet, you know, put on the rifle, that's when we realized how serious this war thing is, you know. And they gave me chicken skin.
For the next 2 months, the Nisei were in constant combat with the enemy. Although the German army was being pushed back, they wanted to delay the Allies as long as possible. To do so, they developed ingenious methods of destruction. The Italian hills were thick with their mines and the roads lined with machine gun nests. The Nisei suffered heavy casualties, the heaviest coming from the barrel of the mighty 88-millimeter artillery gun.
It's a terrifying sound. First bang that you hear, that loud bang, is not the cannon going off. That's a shell exploding. Then you hear the whistle. Then you hear the bang of the gun going off. That's how fast that shell gets. When you hear the bang, it's already all over. You know, it's exploding in your mess.
In the face of this destruction, the 100th was forming into a tough fighting unit. In one battle near Kali, four separate Nisei won Distinguished Service Crosses, the military's second highest honor. But these first months were trial runs, mere prelude to the Nisei soldiers' first true test. In the eyes of the Army, the 100th was still a question mark, until the assault on Cassino. Cassino was keystone to the German Gustav Line, the last line of defense before Rome. If the town of Cassino fell, the Allies were certain to take the Italian capital. But to take the town, the Allies had to secure the monastery, a 4th-century abbey which towered over the valley and which the Germans had made a near impenetrable fortress. The 100th arrived near Cassino just before New Year's as part of the 34th Infantry, the famed Red Bull Division.
Taking the town of Cassino or the monastery itself, you would be taking or trying to defeat the Germans at their strongest point, rather than to go around or through at some other location, which could be attacked much easier. For some strange reason, the American High Command decided that Cassino was important enough that we were to take the city and or the monastery and the hill with a frontal assault.
The 100th was to lead the attack.
It looked to us like almost an impossible task, but that's the job we were given. The Germans had cut all the trees, leveled all the buildings. They had made sure that there was no obstacle to hinder their view, so they saw us coming all the way.
At midnight on January 15th, companies A and C of the 100th began the assault. As they moved forward in the darkness, the Germans began a shower of mortar fire. This turned into a torrent, and by dawn, the remnants of the attack were stopped only halfway across the plain. Then the division commander ordered B Company to attack the next day. He wanted this reserve troop to attack in broad daylight. Sakai Takahashi led the 100 men of this company as they moved across the plain under the cover of smoke. But the wind shifted, and the smoke was blown away.
We proceeded to attack, hell broke loose. The machine gun fire from both sides. And by the time we crossed this flooded plain and reached the wall, well, there were only 11 men and 3 officers left.
The decimation of B Company convinced the division commander that a frontal assault on Cassino was impossible. He ordered the 100th to withdraw. A few weeks later, the 100th was part of another Allied assault. This advance moved into the town from the north. Here, the Nisei were assigned to take the monastery, and the Germans were waiting for them. Under intense mortar fire, the Nisei still advanced 3/4 of the way up the hill. No further. The barrage was too heavy and the casualties too many. The 100th and the rest of the 34th pulled back.
We lost so many casualties at this point that at some point somebody had to do something because we couldn't go through it. We couldn't go around it. We had no choice but to blast it off the face of the earth.
3 days later, Allied leaders ordered an aerial assault on the monastery. As waves of bombers unleashed their weapons on Monastery Hill, the historic abbey was leveled to rubble. Even this would not be enough. In all, the Allies would need 4 months, 5 divisions, and countless tons of bombs to take Cassino from the Germans. In 2 weeks of fighting at Cassino, the 100th suffered heavy casualties. One company, which began at Salerno with 180 men, walked off Monastery Hill with only 30. Despite these losses and despite the failure to take Monastery Hill, in Nisei's eyes, Cassino was a great victory. The 100th had taken a dangerous assignment and almost succeeded. To the Japanese-American soldier, their loyalty had been proven. Soon the Nisei realized they had only passed their first test. After Cassino, the Nisei soldiers of the 100th were brought back towards Naples for a brief rest. In this camp, the mood was quite bright, and the Nisei soldiers were anxious to get back into action.
I think as a result of Cassino, we had a sense of feeling that we'd arrived, that we were really a really good, good outfit. And we felt that in our bones, that we knew we could do as well, if not better, than almost any unit we were facing.
Stories of the 100th success soon filtered back stateside. No one was more excited by this news than the young recruits of the 442nd Combat Team in training in Camp Shelby, Mississippi. Just after the Battle of Midway, after the fear of Japanese invasion was lifted, President Roosevelt announced the formation of an all-Nisei, all-volunteer regiment, the 442nd Combat Team. On Hawaii, this call to arms was met with a rousing response. 10,000 men signed up for 1,500 spots. Among them, Daniel Inouye. In relocation camps, the enthusiasm for volunteering was not as strong. By the winter of 1943, Japanese Americans began to resent their incarceration. Even though the fear of a Japanese attack was gone, the Issei and Nisei were still unable to return home. At Gila River, Jimmy Makino decided to sign up, and this didn't sit well with everyone in camp.
Dad didn't want to accept the fact that we were incarcerated, and here I'm going to go into service and serve a country that has incarcerated us like this. My dad asked if I would not reconsider. I said, no, I have signed up, and I'm going to go. And I know a lot of the neighbors weren't too happy about the whole affair.
Jimmy Makino persisted, and he became one of the 1,500 volunteers from relocation camps. Included in the group from Amache were George and Calvin Saito. In late May 1943, the 100th rejoined the 34th Division, then stationed at the beachhead at Anzio. Even though the Nisei were not in the vanguard of the breakout from the beach, they were in the forefront of the march towards Rome. Even though 6 Nisei won Distinguished Service Crosses in this drive, it was here the 100th learned what respect the Army really had for them.
When we were about a mile or a mile and a half on the outskirts of Rome, 100 Battalion was stopped, you know, and they told us to wait, don't advance anymore. So we went off the side of the road. Everybody got in a ditch and sat around. And the boys were, I don't know what outfit it was, but they were all white boys coming down, you know, in the half track and the jeeps and everything. And they went through us and they went toward Rome. Some of the boys says, hey, you know, the higher ups, you know, they don't want the first American troops in Rome to be Japanese.
The Nisei of the 100th never got to Rome. They now realized for them to truly win the Army's respect, they would have to win a victory. At their next camp, the 100th's chance at this victory was complicated by the arrival of the young Nisei of the 442nd. The 100th kept its designation, but became part of this larger combat team. The volunteers of the 442nd were anxious to prove themselves, to fight separate from the veterans of the 100th. The young Nisei were in the forefront of the very next attack. On June 26th, the two battalions of the 442nd moved towards their first objective, the town of Belvedere. The young Nisei never reached the town. German artillery spotted them long before Belvedere and began an assault. As shells tore into their ranks, the young Nisei were panicked and their attack ground to a halt.
I remember being behind a hill and this tremendous barrage came, and only maybe about 25 yards or 30 yards away, all the shells were falling. And all, while the thing was going on, all these red flames were going and everything, I saw a figure standing on a hill there. I kept looking, and I thought, gee, that must be Sakai Takahashi.
The 100th Battalion, led by Sakai Takahashi, had been called in. In a stunning end run, they marched 10 miles and put themselves behind the German line. From his perch on the hill, Captain Takahashi ordered an attack.
Well, we had a field day. We knocked out the artillery battery that was firing. We probably captured about 175 prisoners and maybe killed an equal number of German soldiers.
Although it began the day in reserve, the 100th Battalion pushed the German line back 7 full miles. For its effort, the 100th was awarded the Distinguished Unit Citation. General Mark Clark, commander of the 5th Army, awarded the decorations.
You're always willing to close with the enemy. He has no bluff on you, and you've always defeated him. And let me tell you again, the 34th Division is proud of you. The 5th Army is proud of you. America is proud of you.
Not long after the Nisei victory at Belvedere, Calvin Saito was killed in fighting near Florence. His brother George wrote to his father, now living in Boston.
Dad, I'm writing now because I've just learned of his passing. This is no time to be preaching to you, but I have something on my chest which I want you to hear. In spite of Calvin's supreme sacrifice, don't let anyone tell you that he was foolish or made a mistake to volunteer. Of what I've seen in my travels on our mission, I am more than convinced that we've done the right thing in spite of what has happened to us in the past. America is our home, and don't let anyone tell you otherwise.
After Belvedere, the 100th, 442nd, was reassigned to the 36th Division, then fighting in northwest France. Major General John Dahlquist was the commander of the 36th.
General Dahlquist was a very ambitious man, and he didn't lack personal physical courage. I don't think soldiers or casualties or anything like that meant anything to him. These were just things to be used to gain personal glory.
For Dahlquist, personal glory meant leading the first Allies into Germany. He would do anything to reach this goal. On October 16th, the 100th and 442nd joined the 36th, just south of Bruyères. Here, Dahlquist believed the first operation would be easy, that the Nisei would face little opposition. Captain Kim and his regimental commander disagreed and expressed their fears to the general.
In the end, we were told to just shut up and go, and not give all these reasons for not fighting. Our purpose was not to say we're not going to fight, but how we fight and how far we're going to go and everything else makes a big difference. You walk out there like there's nobody out there, and there's somebody out there, then you're in for trouble. Well, there was. We advanced 10 yards that first day.
After 2 days of combat, the 100th 442nd finally took Hill A, capturing 40 German machine guns and 100 Nazi prisoners. When the Nisei presented these trophies to Dahlquist, he told them, They should have taken the hill sooner. Fierce German opposition didn't fit into General Dahlquist's plan. He hoped with the Nisei soldiers to advance 10 kilometers a day. But the Germans put up stiff resistance. They were being pushed back to their homeland and fought each battle as if it were their last. Dahlquist, however, would not give in.
I think it was just a matter of time, and eventually Doc was going to put somebody out there beyond artillery and beyond friendly fire and beyond communications and everything. And he was just asking for it. A good example is that it's 100th in Bifontaine.
On October 22nd, as the 100th captured the town of Bifontaine, the German lines closed in behind them. Since they were driven so hard, the Nisei were cut off without heavy arms or supplies. On this day, the 100th was lucky. The other two battalions of the 442nd soon cracked through the Germans and drove them away from the 100th. At this point, the Nisei had been fighting for two straight weeks without a rest. The moment they got a break, they also got news that another battalion of the 36th was cut off.
They told us we were going to go back to rest for about 3 or 4 days. And we went back one day, and that very night that we got back, they told us we got to go back up front. This was 2 o'clock in the morning, and I couldn't find my rifle, and I couldn't find my shelter half. You know, it was pitch dark in the forest.
When they got up to the front lines, the Nisei learned the 141st Battalion of the 36th was encircled by an entire division of Germans.
It was a battalion of Texans that had moved too fast and therefore got sucked in by the Germans. At first, attempts were made by the Texas regiments to rescue this battalion, but they were not quite successful. So they called us in.
With this assignment, the Nisei again learned their value to the U.S. Army. Even though Dahlquist had other battalions of the 36th ready to rescue the lost battalion, he sent only 2,000 Nisei against almost 8,000 Germans.
Most of us realized at that point that we were dispensable. If too many Texans died, it would have been terrible thing for the division. But if we died, it was no big thing. Even if we were expendable, we realized that this was an opportunity that we were waiting for to really demonstrate something.
The attack began on October 27th, and by 8 a.m., the Nisei had run into a wall of German defense. A solid line of tanks and machine gun nests. For 2 days, the Nisei soldiers were pinned in foxholes, able to advance only a few hundred yards. The deadliest fire came from tree bursts. Artillery shells exploded at treetop level, raining shrapnel through the forest. Time was running short for the lost battalion, and General Dahlquist was getting impatient.
Somebody was yelling from behind us, "Go get him, you know. Come on, let's go, you know." And this was the general from the 36th Division, you know. And he was yelling at us to go and move, you know. Before you knew it, the German machine gun opened up, and the general just took off.
General Dahlquist was not around on October 29th when Company K of the 3rd Battalion began a banzai charge. Two dozen Nisei threw themselves into the teeth of the German line. Other Nisei followed. Finally, late on the next day, the first Japanese Americans made contact with the lost battalion. The Texans were saved. In 2 weeks of fighting with Dahlquist's 36th Division, the Nisei combat team suffered 882 casualties. Just in the rescue of the lost battalion, 161 Nisei met their death. A few days after the rescue, General Dahlquist learned of the cost of his ambition.
After the rescue, the division commander, 36th Division commander, ordered our colonel to assemble the regiment in a formal parade formation so that he could formally express the gratitude of the division. And when we assembled in that field in France, the general turned to the colonel and said, "I told you, Colonel, I wanted the whole regiment out there. Apparently you sent most of your men out on pass." And the colonel said, "No, that is the regiment." And that just horrified the general. He didn't realize that the casualties were that high.
For their efforts in the Vosges Forest, both in liberating Bruyères and in rescuing the lost battalion, the Nisei Combat Team earned not one, but two distinguished unit citations. Dahlquist himself presented both of these honors.
It was a very costly mission, but we succeeded. And after that, no one questioned our loyalty and patriotism.
During the campaign in the Vosges Forest, Private George Saito was struck by enemy machine gun fire. His sister Mary received news of this while working in Boston.
Mrs. Greenough came to the institute where I was working. They received a telegram, and she asked the boy who delivered it what the news was, and he said, yes, it was bad news. And so instead of giving the telegram to my father, she came down to get me. And then we broke the news to Dad.
George Saito's body was returned to the United States and buried along with his brother Calvin in Los Angeles, California. The war was over for most original members of the 100th, but not for the 442nd. In March, these soldiers returned to Italy again to fight with the 34th Division. Many of these Nisei were eager to return to combat, to have the chance to fight out of the shadow of the 100th. The 442nd's objective was the German Gothic Line, a mountainous string of fortifications across the top of the Italian peninsula. For 5 months, the 34th tried to break this line. For 5 months, they failed. That was before the Nisei of the 442nd arrived. The 442nd began its assault at dawn of April 5th. At one point during the battle, a Los Angeles Nisei began a one-man grenade attack on a German machine gun nest. As Sadao Munemori ran back towards the safety of a foxhole, the Germans tossed their own grenades.
A grenade had landed on him, and it started rolling toward a foxhole. And before it got to the foxhole, he jumped on it, and it exploded with him on top of it, killing him.
For his heroism, Munemori was posthumously given the highest military award, the Medal of Honor, the first and only Nisei soldier so honored in this war. Soon after Munemori's death, the mighty Gothic line was in shambles. The 442nd broke the German defenses, not in a week, as their commander hoped, but in a mere 12 hours. For this, the Nisei soldiers received their fourth distinguished unit citation, clearly proving they were the 100th's equal. As the Gothic line fell, other Nisei to the north discovered the full evil of their fascist enemy. In his diary, a young Nisei lieutenant describes the opening of the gates of the concentration camp, Dachau.
I watched as one of the scouts used his carbine to shoot off the chain that held the prison gates shut. He had to open the gates when he saw a couple of prisoners moving weakly. They weren't dead as we had first thought. They were like skeletons, skin and bones. Ichiro Imamura.
On May 2nd, The German army finally surrendered in Italy, and within a week, peace was declared throughout Europe. Even though the Nazi Reich was over, there was little to celebrate for the Nisei soldiers of the 100th and 442nd. When they went to war, the Nisei believed if they performed well, Americans would finally accept them as equal citizens. At Cassino, at Belvedere, and in the Vosges Forest, they performed as few units ever had. Yet on their return home, the Nisei had doubts that earning medals would also earn them respect. As they returned from war and from relocation camps, Japanese Americans were faced by another enemy, racism. Jimmy Makino's father discovered he was unable to return to the produce business he had left 3 years before. Even though he had lost two sons in the defense of the country, Kaichi Saito was still unable to become a U.S. citizen. In Hawaii, many Nisei found a different type of racism. As these soldiers returned to the plantations where their parents worked, they found they could earn only meager wages for their labor. Before the war, the Issei credo was, the nail that stands up will get knocked down. But now, the returning Nisei veterans were not afraid to stand up. In combat, the Nisei gained something else besides medals. They gained self-respect. Mike Tokunaga realized this when he tried to see the opening of the United Nations. After being refused entrance, he asked to see the colonel in charge.
We went down to see the colonel, and he gave us one look, and when he saw that Purple Heart ribbon, and he says, I notice you all got a Purple Heart. And tell him, yeah, you know. He says, come on, and he took us in from the side door, and he set us right up front, you know. And we watched the proceedings for 1 hour, and we came out, and I told the two guys, you know, I feel like a first-class citizen now, you know, and this Purple Heart did it, you know.
After the war, Mike Tokunaga became a labor leader organizing the workers in the plantation for better wages and working conditions. On the mainland, many of the Nisei veterans fought to become first-class citizens through education. The GI Bill paid for hundreds of Nisei to attend college. Nisei veterans had their most dramatic impact on the Hawaiian Islands. In the last week of the war, Daniel Inoue lost his right arm to a German rifle-propelled grenade. As he recuperated in an army hospital, Inoue and another wounded Nisei, Sakai Takahashi, decided to devote themselves to changing Hawaiian politics. Soon, Nisei held offices in every branch of Hawaiian politics. Then the Nisei turned their efforts to making Hawaii a greater part of the United States. On August 21, 1959, largely because of the Nisei soldiers, Hawaii became the 50th state, and Daniel Inouye was named its first representative in Congress. In 1962, he became senator. Just before Hawaii gained statehood, another Nisei won a smaller battle. On June 12, 1959, after losing two sons in service to the country, and after spending 2 years incarcerated for being an enemy of the country, Kaichi Saito was sworn in as a citizen of the United States. The success of the Nisei in battle and on their return home could not deny him the citizenship he craved.
The challenge of racism. How the Nisei dealt with this challenge is the true legacy they leave us. When most of America looked upon them as enemies, as less than men, the Nisei did not lash out, did not counter hatred with more hatred. Instead, they fought this anger with heroic action. And in that action on the battlefields of Italy and France, the Nisei soldiers of the 100th Battalion and the 442nd Combat Team not only conquered the evil of their Nazi enemy, but they began to conquer the evil of racism.
While those two units were fighting for the United States, many of their relatives were still held in the internment camps. Some would remain in confinement for up to 4 years, even though there wasn't a single case of Japanese-American espionage throughout the Second World War. Finally, in 1988, Congress passed a bill awarding each survivor $20,000. Each survivor also received an official apology from the President of the United States, George Bush. For the History Channel, I'm Roger Mudd. Thanks for watching.